Anything, what happened?
Okay.
Yeah, now you are able to hear audio check.
Yes.
Audio check. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm able to hear you also. So I think we are set. We can start in a couple of minutes when our group captain starts.
Okay, fine. So this voice level is sufficient, no?
Yeah, this is fine. This is fine. This is fine. You're doing fine. You're doing fine.
Okay. All power. Now power came.
Okay. Okay. We are now ready to start. So once group captain takes over, we'll follow the flow of the event. Okay.
Yeah. Sure.
Sorry, Avis, at the place where IBC gives the service, there also no power. So we are technically shut out now. And I told him, so I cannot mute myself. Anyway, we'll see that later.
You can mute yourself.
We can't do that.
Because you can't do that. Okay.
Actually, I muted myself. So I'm unable to do that. Anyway. Ready to go, Avis?
Yeah, I'm ready to go. Yeah. Madhvi, you're set?
Yeah.
Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Very warm welcome to another edition of our evening talk. We have been keeping you busy from the time 25th of March till now. Our endeavor is to keep you busy till the third lockdown ends on 17th of May. Hopefully, I think it'll end. The trend shows something different, but my heart says it'll end and we are get on to the work and start earning your living and start enjoy doing what you believe in doing all through the day. And you all know we start our work from morning till 7 o'clock in the morning till late in the evening, 8 o'clock. We start with the yoga every morning, which has become very popular. We are doing jointly with Isha Yoga. Then at 8 o'clock, you are getting a bunch of quizzes, which is again become very popular. Every day we get some 1,000 plus participants in that. Thereafter, 11 every morning, we bring you an outstanding speaker to speak to you. Then from lunch, 1 o'clock, we share with you some lovely articles written by thought leaders. 2 to 5:30, we are doing a continuous workshop, certificate course, training course for you. Again, in the evening, 6 o'clock, we have again, excellent talk by an outstanding leader, one such one, which are going to listen to you just now, just a while ago from now. So this has been keeping you busy. And I want to tell you, maybe we have sent you so many emails coming from MMA. Sometime you would have missed an inbox because data shows we have sent a couple of lakhs of email, lakhs of SMSs for the last 45 days to keep the members engaged. Let me tell you briefly what's happening next few days. On the 8th of May, again, getting ready for the future. That is the event which you are going to do that during COVID-19. This is, we have Dr. Uppalari, Srinivas Uppalari is a former global head of Infosys marketing. He's going to be talking to us. He's also advisor, leadership coach, and is actually going to focus on sharpening your go-to mindset and getting the whole thing realizing what you wanted and building institutional capability at strategical level. It's going to be very important because all of our theme most of the time is COVID related. We want the people to get really enriched and insightful on some of the topics which you would otherwise don't do. On 9th of May, we have an exclusive program from international speaker from Chicago. He's going to talk to us on time management. This program, we are taking it exclusively for the management students. We expect about 6,000 management students attend this event. This is happening at morning 9 a.m. because of the time difference of USA. Indian Standard Time, 9 a.m. because by the time we finish the talk, it'll be 12 o'clock for the gentleman. But we want to bring it for the student, 9 o'clock. If members want to join, please do welcome. Time management is very, very important because you've got all the time in the world at your disposal with COVID-19. Let's see how you can manage your time efficiently and energetically. So this, you are going to get input from one of our international speakers, Dr. Manu Vora. Then on 9th of May, again 6 p.m. in the evening, we are going to outstanding talk for you. Two outstanding doctors are going to share their insight. Access your way to the stress-free life. We got Dr. Ennapadam Krishnamurthy. He is the founder of Budhi Clinic. You all know one of the very known mind management doctors. And also Dr. Sheila Nambia, she also runs a fitness studio. So they both are going to be in conversation and sharing with you, access your way to the stress-free life, and which I think it's a quite useful topic for the current scenario. Then on 11th of May, we've got another experienced outstanding speaker of international repute, Customer Experience in a COVID World. It's by Debashish Sarkar. He's a lean specialist. He's going to be talking to us on the 11th of May. Then we also start a leadership series. Our intention is to talk Leaders Speak series, under which leaders will share their insight on how India can push the boundaries and drive in post-COVID world order. Idea is, we have been listening to so many thought leaders, corporate leaders, and we bring in a bunch of them. Here we are going to select exclusively top political leaders from different organizations, different parties to come and share on different subjects actually. The first one is starting, in fact, we already 13th and 14th, we already invited Veerappa Mouli to talk on center-state relationship, which you are the part of the thing. It's confirmation awaited. But 15th of May, we have an outstanding speaker, Bharatwari Mehta. He's a member of parliament and also member of Biju Janata Dal from Orissa. And this gentleman is a sixth time parliamentarian. And last year, he was declared as one of the outstanding parliamentarians. Because we want to come and showcase to you, we got some fantastic parliamentarians and politicians who will share. He's going to speak to us on COVID-19, the impact on Indian economy. So we are also inviting a number of other people. We are going to bring in Supriya Sule to speak on center-state relationship and how the state-level party is going to change. We were also trying to get Jairam Ramesh to go in on India-China relationship. He has written a book on recently. Then we also were trying to get Arjun Ram Meghawal, Minister for State Parliament, to speak to us, center-state relationship and what is going to happen. He is also public sector undertaking minister. He's going to talk to us on what is going to happen in public sector disinvestment on those policies. We also labor reform. We are getting some outstanding speakers to come and speak, politicians. Next 1 month, we'll have a series of thought leaders coming and talking to you. This, I thought I'll tell you, this is what is going to be happening. Besides that, on the 16th of May, we are also finalizing a brand summit. It will happen between 11 to 1 o'clock. On the 16th of May, we are joining and doing this jointly with Equita. But come to an end, and because Avis is very strict for timing, my timing is only 5 minutes. I think I'm going to touch that moment any moment. And let me tell you, we are doing so many events. You keep thinking these are some of the important, not to be missed event actually. Avis and Madhavi, very warm welcome to you. It's always a pleasure to work with Avis, so professional and so enterprising, and you will bring the best out of the speaker room. His conversation is engaging. That's one of the art of Avis, which always admire, and we try to emulate him, but may fail miserably. Notwithstanding, let me have the privilege of introducing Avis, because he will introduce the speaker. Avis is a happiness swallow. Usually, that's what we tell him. But today, since he has no control over me, I think I'll ask some more lines about Avis. Avis is an inspired speaker, life coach, author. He also written a book, Fall Like a Rose Petal, which he had the privilege of launching in MMA. He also specializes in leading workplace happiness and culture transformation mandate organizations globally. That is what is Avis. And you all know Avis is no stranger to MMA. We had a series of programs for the last couple of years. And let me also briefly welcome Madhavi Madam. And it's always a pleasure. And just to singularly define what is Madhavi Madam, as far as I think of, Avis will be introducing her in detail. She's a president of Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India. And one thing which Madhavi always believes, she takes no for as an answer for life or from anyone. So you know what determined person she is. And you're going to listen to how she has built an inspiring career despite of all the odds, because we are at odds now with the COVID-19 happening. So you will add some fantastic lessons during this conversation, which will be really, really inspiring, maybe change the life what you have been leading so far. Thanks so much, madam, for joining us.
Thank you.
Large number of viewers. Now, over to Avis, as usual, please take it forward and look forward to a great, interesting, enriching conversation between you and Madhavi, madam.
Thank you. Thank you, Vijay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to yet another edition of The Uncommon Leader. This series is special because we get an opportunity to work with Group Captain Vijay Kumar and his wonderful team at MMA. Normally, we are so used to their hospitality at MMA Center. This is the first time we are doing it online and on Zoom. Yet, I feel the warmth, I feel the professionalism, and I cannot start today's session without commending Team MMA for the way, the seamless way in which they work. So thank you once again for that. Thank you, Madhavi, for joining us this evening. I'm going to come back to you and you know come to you in a few moments. But I'm going to actually start as always, because there will be always new people listening and watching this conversation series. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about who we are and why we do the Uncommon Leader series. So there on the screen, you must be able to see Vani. Vani and I, we are the Happiness Walas.
Yes.
We are living a life of purpose. We believe our life's purpose is inspiring happiness. We have a very interesting story out there. Do Google us, HAPPYNESSWALAS, Happiness Walas. Google us, and it should be able to take you to links on us. However, just to give you an overview of our journey, Vani and I, we are dealing with a fascinating, life-changing experience. We're dealing with a crippling bankruptcy for the last 13 years. This means for the longest time in this past decade, we've been dealing with prolonged spells of worklessness and pennilessness, oftentimes pennilessness. Yes, you heard that right. This essentially means that we've been struggling on the material front in our life, and this has pinned us to the ground. It has been an extremely painful journey for us. Yet, in this time, we discovered something magical. We discovered something beautiful, which is we learned to be happy despite our painful circumstances. And we learned this by training our mind to be non-worrying, non-frustrated, and non-suffering. Now, when you're non-worrying, non-frustrated, and non-suffering, you can only be happy. When we came to this understanding, it was a eureka moment for us. So on the one side, we were struggling with making our business successful, turning it around, and success was eluding us. So we were not being successful, and we still are not successful in a worldly sense. We still don't cover our living expenses month on month, and we are dealing with prolonged spells of when we don't get enough work or enough money. So when we are going through a phase when success is elusive, we asked ourselves, how can we be useful? So we flipped the paradigm. How can we be useful even if we can't be successful in a worldly sense? And that led me to launch my book, Fall Like a Rose Petal, in 2014. This book traces our journey through the bankruptcy, but more importantly, it chronicles the lessons that we have learned on how to be happy and content while living without money. This journey also meant that we retool our business. And so we run today a small boutique workplace happiness firm called AV Initiatives, where we inspire, through our programs, we inspire managers to higher performance. And we do that by helping them distill lessons on life and happiness from the lived experiences around us from human stories. Vani and I also curate and host 3 live, free, non-commercial conversations across Chennai. 2 of them are hosted by the ODC Bookstore in Adyar. And the 3rd one, the Uncommon Leader Series, the one that you are attending today, this one is hosted and supported by the Madras Management Association. The Uncommon Leader Series is special because it celebrates the spirit of entrepreneurship that we see around us, but from unique contexts. The people that we have consistently been inviting as guests to come to the series, these people have demonstrated one important quality, which is they've always gone beyond the question of what's in it for me. They go beyond personal profits in whatever venture they're leading, and they look at how can we create a better world. These guests are often from non-corporate, non-business backgrounds, though occasionally we do bring people with corporate and business experience. We also focus on the fact that the journeys of these people must necessarily have a teachable or a learnable point of view from which we can glean learnings for people in corporates, in business leadership positions, people who are entrepreneurs, and for students of management. But the most fascinating thing about these people is that they're all happy folks. They're people who love what they're doing. They're people who believe in what they're doing. And that is what makes Vani and me curate this series, because our own life's purpose is inspiring happiness. Madhavi Lata, this evening, ladies and gentlemen, is one such uncommon leader. She is guest number 33 in this edition number 28 of the Uncommon Leader. The format we have this evening is that I will be in conversation with Madhavi for about 60 to 65 minutes, and then we will open up the floor for your questions. You may drop your questions in the chat box here if you're on Zoom, or on your respective devices, if you're on Facebook or on YouTube, on your respective interfaces, and the questions will be picked up by me or by Group Captain Vijay Kumar, and we will ask Madhavi to answer those questions for you. We will go all the way till 7:25, and then I will be handing it over to Group Captain Vijay Kumar to close the evening for us. We will end sharp at 7:30, as we always do. I had a very interesting comment that I managed to chance to look at from a gentleman who said, "Avis, this time you will not be able to give us hugs if we ask the questions." And I want to reiterate, you will all get virtual happiness hugs from me. And even if we were live at the venue at MMA Center, I would have still given you only virtual hugs. Given the times that we live in, so the hugs are there, provided you keep asking us very sharp questions. But we'll come to that in the end. Let me now introduce Madhavi to you. Madhavi was introduced to us by a wonderful uncommon leader himself, Raja Rajashekaran of VSESH. VSESH is an organization that Raja and his colleague, Shashank, started in 2009. They started VSESH so that they could empower and help employ people with disabilities. VSESH is a small but thriving team of 35 committed people. They connect with over 100 organizations across the country. And just in the last 3 years, they have placed about 2,000 people with special needs and disabilities. Raja and Shashank were our guests in the September 2017 edition of the Uncommon Leader Series. So thank you, Raja, for that introduction. When Raja introduced us to Madhavi and when we heard our story, we were like, completely inspired. We invited Madhavi to have coffee with us at Starbucks. We chose the venue for the meeting at Starbucks, Kadar Nawaz Khan Road, because we understood that the venue was accessible and was friendly for people with wheelchair needs. When Madhavi arrived, we discovered that it wasn't so friendly and it wasn't so accessible after all. By the way, she came driving alone in her car. She got onto her wheelchair from the street, took the ramp, crossed a couple of small hurdles before she was seated next to us in the cafe. And we found in her no trace of bitterness, frustration, or any sense of anger over the fact that parking had been a challenge or that getting into the cafe had been a challenge. And I remember telling Vani as she narrated her story and we got back home on our drive back in our Uber, I remember telling Vani that one of the most striking qualities of Madhavi is that she cannot take no for an answer. Not from no, she can't take no for an answer from life, and she can't take no for an answer from anyone. Consider some of her, some of the details of her life. When she was 7 months old, she was struck by polio. And yet she goes on to pick up 3 degrees in math, public administration, and history. And then she has spent 29 years in the banking sector. More than half of that time has been spent, or close to half of that time has been spent in the multinational banking environment, which is a highly competitive, high performance environment. In 2007, as if all of the challenges that she had with polio was not enough, life sent her a googly, which is she was diagnosed with a condition called post-polio syndrome, and her doctors gave her just about a year to live. Madhavi embraced hydrotherapy as a form of treating that condition. She became an ace para swimming champion, won several medals at the national and international level, and discovered that sports actually gave her life a new meaning. She discovered the potential in wheelchair basketball. And not only did she embrace the sport for herself, but she decided to set up the Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India in 2014. And today the federation has touched 650 people with special needs and disability. And those people have found a sense of meaning, a sense of purpose in playing wheelchair basketball. Sitting on her wheelchair, Madhavi right now, just as she is seated right now, sitting on her wheelchair, she is continuously monitoring the activities, leading the activities of the Wheelchair Basketball Federation, which ranges from sourcing funds to finding volunteers to finding mentors, coaches, and stadia, infrastructure, and of course, running camps and taking the team international to participate in different tournaments. That's Madhavi Lata for you, ladies and gentlemen. She is resilience personified. She is an uncommon leader. And let me now invite her and start the conversation with her. Madhavi, are you feeling good?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Davis, for the wonderful introduction. And thank you so much, Madras Management Association, Group Captain Vijay Kumar, sir. I'm very, very happy. Though we are not able to meet in person, this is a wonderful meeting. Thank you so much for inviting me for this great initiative.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhavi, for joining us. So let's get started with the conversation. Let me ask you my first question. Given the fact that you were struck by polio when you were just an infant, about 7 months old, it is really, really inspiring to know how you went on kind of pick up not just one, but 3 academic degrees in math, public administration, and history. So my first question is, how did you manage all this? What kind of an appetite did you have for education to manage all this?
Major credit goes to my parents. And I have a beautiful, loving, and caring family. Family means not only my parents and siblings, both my paternal and maternal side also. They all love me very much. I am from a remote area, not now, but in those days. remote area, Sattupalli in Telangana state, present Telangana state. My father worked as a school headmaster at that time, and my mother is a housewife. I have three elder sisters and one elder brother. I am the youngest one. So in my family, like they used to treat me, they treat me even today like a princess. So princess doesn't mean that we have ports, everything like that. Ours is a middle class family, but the love and affection they showed me is great. They used to carry me in their hands in those days. We didn't have any wheelchair, such type of things. They used to take me to school or any other places, movie theaters or anywhere, wherever we want. They went, they took me. They never left me in at home and going like that. I up to 10th standard, I went to school with the support of either my father or my brother. They used to carry me in their hands or on bicycle. And after 10th standard, I could not go to college due to non-availability of infrastructure facilities. So I started appearing privately. From that time, all my studies, both academic and later professional, everything by appearing privately only. I like mathematics. It's my favorite subject. So I wanted to take any group related to mathematics, where mathematics is also there. So that's why I did my graduation in with the main subjects as mathematics, history, and public administration. Wherever my examinations happen, all the places used to be in second floor or third floor without lift. My father, literally, he used to carry me till degree. Till I was 19 years old, he used to carry me in his hands. It's so nice that I always admire in those days in villages, you know very well, giving importance for girls' education, how it was in those days. But they have very great progressive thinking in those days, and my mother and father both gave more importance for girls' education. They never thought that this girl is having severe disability, why should we encourage her in studies? Never. So that made me to complete graduation successfully. And when I stopped going outside, so I started conducting tuitions with the intention to bring external world to me, because I love to mingle with the people. Because I started appearing privately, I could not meet people. So with that intention, I started conducting tuitions. I strongly recommend that one for all the students. Do something when you are studying. That helped me a lot. One, I didn't miss my college days fun, because all my students are just 1 year juniors to me. And next one is, it gave me, I had to work more to teach them that subject just with 1 year difference. So that gave me, that improved my knowledge. And third one, it gave me more confidence. My parents used to tell me that I must work. I must be independent. I should not be a burden for anyone. So that gave me confidence. Even if I don't get any job, okay, this option is there for me, like that. And another one, some students with financial challenges, I could support them. So that also gave me a nice feeling. So my family is behind me.
So it's the precious family of Madhavi Lata that has held the princess together and led her way. I can definitely see that. Thank you for sharing it with such great detail. But I want to pick up on a few learnings. So for those of you who are new to this format, this is not a talk. This is not a conventional interview. It's not a panel discussion. It is a conversation. So I'm picking up some learnings from Madhavi. So I'm going to share some learnings with you, Madhavi. What I'm seeing when you say when you were in, were not able to continue high school and you started teaching children, students who were 1 year your junior, all through your high school and through your college, you kept teaching people who were 1 year your junior. That quality of yours, the very thought of doing that in order that you don't miss your college life is very beautiful. And to me, it's reflective of three important traits that entrepreneurs and leaders must possess, which is the power of reflection, the power of resilience, and the power of resourcefulness. The power of reflection is asking yourself, what is my current reality and how can I change it? What must I do? Second is the power of resilience, which is your inner strength, that you're dealing with a challenging situation and the pressure will get to you at some time, but how do you manage that pressure? And the third is you have only limited resources. She is immobile. She cannot move around. In those days, wheelchair access is bad today, but then you can imagine 20 years, 30 years ago, or for 35 years ago, how it must have been. So given your challenges, what is the best you can do in a given circumstance? So the power of reflection, resilience, resourcefulness, these three come out in your story, in your sharing that, Madhavi. And I feel every entrepreneur must spend time to unlock these three traits in them. Reflection, why am I here? What is my current reality and how to deal with it? Resilience, how to unlock my inner strength and deal with the pressure that's cooking when things get tough. And most importantly, here's what I have. What can I do with my limited resources, which is resourcefulness? Interestingly, to deal with COVID-19 and the challenges that we are going through right now and the challenges that we are going to see for the next couple of years or maybe longer, you need the three R's: reflection, resilience, resourcefulness. Let me move on and ask Madhavi. You did talk about job, and that triggered a question in me. You said, even if I don't get a job, I can look after myself by teaching youngsters. But you eventually got a job and you have almost a 30-year career already in the banking sector. But I'm quite sure, Madhavi, it must have been very challenging to get a job for yourself. How did you manage that?
Yeah, definitely it's a quite challenging task, that one. You know that the career counseling in those days in villages, we can't expect at all. So even non-disabled people, they didn't have much idea about career opportunities. So naturally, in my case, in my family, my father used to think girls should take up either teaching profession or doctor profession. But in my case, teaching profession, he thought that it might be difficult to move around like that. Then we had to think about the alternate other option. So at that time, we came to know about that LIC office is there. Generally, LIC offices will be there even in villages. So we thought of applying for that. And when I applied, I was waiting for the hall ticket. It won't come like a normal way. It is like on merit base they will send. I didn't get. And after that, I came to know the people who got lesser marks than me, they got it. Then when we checked with them, they told that for that particular position, persons with legs-related disabilities are not allowed.
Oh, okay.
Then they told that when we checked about what are other options, they told about a typist post. But I didn't know typing at that time. Again, I started learning typing and I completed English higher in first class. At that time, one of my cousins told me that he saw some people like me in banks. So we thought that there might be opportunities. So I appeared for that written test interview. That written test also in fifth floor. My father carried me.
Wow.
So after that, everything was over. Then just before taking appointment letter, I received a telegram. And nowadays, we have so many other options, Thursday's telegrams. So there they told that I need not come to Hyderabad to take the appointment letter because doctor told that I was unfit for that post. And we came to know that he's a children's specialist. Without referring to orthopedic surgeon, he rejected my case. Later, we went to Hyderabad. We met so many doctors. We gave representation. Somehow, after 3 months, my batchmates joined in March. I joined in June. Finally, I could get that bank job. So in that entire effort, after coming back, our villagers got surprised. Without knowing anyone in Hyderabad, these parents taking her there and finally getting success in that one, they could not imagine that type of situation. So it's a wonderful experience. Finally, I got a job in bank and I worked in various places. like agriculture banking, retail banking, and I went to Hyderabad, their corporate finance, foreign exchange, so many areas I worked. And in that process, I learned driving because I wanted to be more independent. So I learned driving first with scooter and later car. I enjoyed driving very much. First time when I started driving, that was one of the best moments in my life. I felt so independent. I need not depend on anyone. I can go wherever I want. I can stay there for whatever time I want. It's a wonderful experience.
You know, just hearing you narrate that fills my heart so much. That's why I kind of celebrated it with a hearty laugh. You remind me of two important songs, two lines in two important songs. This particular answer of yours, the way in which you handled your life. It's these two songs are very powerful. I don't know, you've been in Chennai for more than a decade. I don't know how much Tamil you know, but the first song is written by Vairamuthu for a Maniratnam film called Iruvar. A.R. Rahman composed the music. I'm not going to sing the song. I'm just going to share a line. And the singer is Mano. And this in this song from Iruvar, which is the song's title is Ayirathil Naan Oruvan. He says that in the ulagam kadavar adaital etti udaipen adu thirakkum, which is if the world shuts the door on me, I will kick it and open it. I'll kick it open. That's what it means. You literally did that, Madhavi. That's the sense that I got when you shared your story of how a pediatrician gave perspective and rejected you from the government sector bank job, and how you went and sought proper orthopedic opinion and fought your case. Amazing. You know, the learning for all of us here is that if you are having an entrepreneurial role, whether you are in a business leadership position or run your own enterprise, or even in your family, if you have an entrepreneurial outlook, one of the things that you should try and do is to not take no for an answer. You should bring that spirit into you, because most entrepreneurial journeys, if you look around you, are of people who have come up with new ideas. Any new idea, any new concept, any new product, any new service, the world will first say no. And Madhavi belongs to a generation, she belongs to an era where people with disabilities, people with wheelchair access, were often denied opportunities. And when I use the metaphorical line of Vairamuthu, that etti udaipen adu thirakkum, you know, that I will kick it open, I literally mean the power with which Madhavi handled that situation. That's truly amazing, Madhavi. Thank you so much. Two songs came to my mind. The other song is also a very, very popular song. And this one is from Rabindranath Tagore. Many of you might know the song. It's Ekla Chalo Re from Rabindranath Tagore. The opening line of the song actually says that Joditor Dakshune Kyuna Asatove Ekla Chalo Re, which is even if nobody responds to your call, please keep moving on. Please keep marching forward alone. And that's the spirit that Madhavi brings to the table. We've lost her for a minute. I'm going to wait for her to come back in. Somebody, Vani or somebody, can check what's going on. There seems to have been some connectivity problem. So what I am picking up is that sense of never say die attitude, and the way in which she looked at it, if LIC says, I cannot handle, we don't accept people who don't have typing background, she's willing to go and learn typing at that time. If the bank, the government sector bank, says, I can't recruit you because you have a walking disability, you have a legs disability, she says, who are you to tell me? If it's a pediatrician, who are you to tell me? I'll give you an orthopedic opinion that I am fit enough to do this job. I think that spirit is what is worth celebrating. I'm wondering what's happening to Madhvi here. She's not on the call. There she is. You came back right at the moment. Otherwise, I was going to ask the third question and wait for you and ask it again.
Just 1 second.
Yeah, you are able to hear me now? Yeah, are you able to hear me now? Yeah, please turn on your audio. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so I think you missed a wonderful memory that came to me of Rabindranath Tagore's Ekla Chalore, which basically means, Madhvi, that if nobody is willing to heed your call, then march alone, march forward alone. That's what you've done. So let's go on. Let me ask you my next question, the third one, which is that anybody in your position, Madhvi, it's a natural question, would have been comfortable with a government sector job, a bank job. It was big stuff in those days, a bank job in a government sector bank, and in Andhra Pradesh / today's Telangana, in Hyderabad, known people, known language, all of that. But you decided to give it all up and move to Chennai, new place, new people, new culture, new language. And most importantly, you moved from government sector to private sector to multinational culture, multinational banking company. Why did you do that? Isn't that too much of an adventure, too much of stepping out of the comfort zone?
Okay, I did first adventure before that itself. Coming from my native place to Hyderabad. It was like a very, very big adventure. In those days, everybody used to tell me, a person with a disability, it is better. Villages are the best places. If they go to cities, nobody will have concern for them. That was the feeling, and many people tried to discourage me. But I love people, and I think that others also will love fellow beings. So I never had that type of fear, and I opted, I wanted to go to Hyderabad. I want to learn so many other things. So then when I was working there in industrial finance branch, I used to meet so many relationship managers from MNC banks because of my job profile. So at that time, they used to tell that working in MNC banks is quite challenging. However work you do here, we can't compare. That is something different. Like that, they used to tell. If somebody challenges me on anything, and it's not like everything I will take it up. Where I feel confidently that I can do, definitely I will take it up. So though my bank was so supportive and I love that bank very much, when they challenged it like that, I wanted to try this. And at the same time, I got some international. I always required so many professional qualifications. I got one international qualification also. Then I got an offer at MNC Bank Group here in Chennai. Then I thought of coming here. But my relatives and friends, my well-wishers, they didn't like my decision. They all thought that, what is this lady? She is having severe disability and she is a woman. And her parents are very old. And they are going to a city which we don't, none of us know about that city, language, no friends, no relatives here. Like that they thought. But after taking any decision, I won't go back. It's not my nature. And luckily, my parents are with me always. Whenever any decision I took, they stood by myself. So I'm very fortunate in that aspect. So three of us came here. And I love even this MNC Bank Group where I am working, very supportive, that management. For my social activities also, I got very wonderful support from them. I love this experience also.
I want people to know that Madhvi's polio condition has left her with 80% of her body being paralyzed. With that, take into account the answer that she just gave, the background that she just gave to moving out of the comfort zone that she could have been in, and how she embraced the challenge and the adventure to join not only a private sector multinational bank, but also to move to a new city, new language, new people. Madhvi, that reminded me of when I was in my 20s. I was a journalist, and I was working with the India Today Group. I remember going to the editor's office, the editor and the founder of the India Today Group, Arun Puri. I remember going to his office and sitting with him, and just behind him, behind his desk, there was a big picture of a turtle with a tortoise with its neck stuck out, and there was a line under that poster which said that the turtle makes progress, the tortoise makes progress only because it is sticking its neck out. So if the entrepreneurial, the leadership lesson for all of us here is that you can be in your comfort zone, but if you want to make progress, if you want to move forward in life, if you want to move and experience the various tastes, the various flavors of life, then you have to stick your neck out. And I think that's literally what Madhavi did. In her case, it's more literal because she's got an 80% body paralysis condition, and she had only to volunteer and move forward by sticking her neck out. So thank you so much, Madhavi, for sharing that anecdote from your life and how it motivated you. Let me go on and ask you a very very pertinent question, perhaps. We're somewhere midway through this conversation, so it's an important time to ask this question. By that time you moved to Chennai, you had already done, you had already been dealing with a lot of challenges, a lot of rejection, and you had come to Chennai and joined the multinational organization, the bank, with a lot of aspirations, dreams. And then in 2007, you were dealt with a very severe blow. You have this condition called post-polio syndrome, and the doctors gave you only one more year to live. Must have been so difficult, Madhavi. How did you cope with this sense of loss and defeat? Did it ever push you into a dark spiral, saying, what the hell is happening to my life, man? Did you ever feel like that?
Yeah, it was a bitter shock. From the beginning, I concentrated more on my studies, later my job, excelling in that, getting professional qualifications. I never bothered about my fitness part. Okay, so I have been sitting and working for so many hours in a day. Because of that, my spine got compressed.
Your spine got compressed.
One lung fully covered, another lung partially. And adding to that, I have this post-polio syndrome. Post-polio syndrome means those who are affected by polio, some people, not everyone, some people may get this challenge. So their muscle energy levels will deteriorate, will get deteriorated. It will happen in a slow manner. So in 2007, it happened, means it suddenly it might have not happened. It might have started earlier, but I didn't observe because of my over enthusiasm like that. After reaching to a stage where I could not sit even for 5 minutes, and my position was like, if I hold something in my hand will pain. If I look this side, my neck will pain. Such a horrible condition, I went to the doctor. After seeing my spine condition, he started dictating his assistant. He didn't even tell me anything. He started telling it was like a death sentence. Within 1 year, what are all the things going to happen? After that, my life would be at risk. And only option, he suggested spinal surgery. And for that also, he told success chances were minimal at that stage. So then we were in distress. We could not understand we were in the dilemma whether to go for surgery or not. So finally, my parents told, we didn't want to see you dying on operation bed. Let's try alternate medicine systems like Ayurvedic, homeo. At that time, one of my students, he became a physiotherapist now. He suggested Anand Jyoti's name. And it's a great transformation that introduction brought a great transformation in my life. He suggested hydrotherapy. So,
Anand Jyoti suggested hydrotherapy. Okay.
So when he suggested, everybody thought how can he suggest hydrotherapy to a person like you? They were all thinking, my family members, relatives, a person like me should not enter into water.
audio. Madhvi, your audio went off.
Share unmute.
Continue, Madhvi.
Hello.
Yeah, continue. Yeah, continue. Yeah. So you went. You need to unmute again. That's fine. Can you speak now, Madhvi? No, it went into mute again. Please touch it very, very gently.
Gentle touch, absolutely correct, yes.
Very gently. Now you're unmuted.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Hello?
Yeah, please go ahead, Madhvi. Please go ahead.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Can I join again? Can I join?
No, can you hear me?
You are strength 5, madam. We are able to hear you. Please go ahead.
You speak.
You speak. Continue to speak. Tell me, mute panitinga 3 p.m. Unmute panitinga. Yes. Just gentle touch. Just leave it as it is. Don't go there.
Yeah. Now speak. Can
I
you
do
hear?
One thing. I'll join again.
Okay. Come back. Okay. So she was telling us that she was going through this phase of utter chaos, confusion. And it so happened that her student referred her, who was a physiotherapist, referred her to another therapist by the name Anand Jyoti, who recommended hydrotherapy for her. So hydrotherapy obviously involved therapy through water. And this is a very important part of Madhvi's story, and I let her come and finish it. But the hydrotherapy part led to a lot of apprehension from people around her, from her own family, as to how she could actually go through a person with her kind of disability, how she could actually go through therapy in water, which possibly involved swimming. So I think that is the part that she was coming to. And this is a very important part in the conversation as well, because at a time when she was given just 1 year to live, which was in 2007, and we are in 2020. So Madhvi defied the odds in surviving beyond 2007, 2008, to come all the way to 2020. Madhvi, please welcome back. Please unmute and continue your story.
Yeah. So when he suggested hydrotherapy, as I told you, everybody scolded the physiotherapist, thinking that he is a mad person. But when I entered into the water, that was like another wonderful moment in my life. I love water very, very much, but nobody allowed till that time. So I had a wonderful time under the water. It's like a world of enjoyment and world of freedom. I need not have my wheelchair or anything to make movements. And underwater, due to water buoyancy, I can make movements very easily. So it was like I can't explain that much happiness. So this all happened because of that doctor's report, right? So I started loving that my physical condition. Because of that only I got the opportunity. And later from hydrotherapy, I started learning swimming and I became a national swimming champion. And we started a state level swimming association. We could support so many other persons with disabilities to learn swimming. Everything happened because of that doctor's report and my medical condition.
So your biggest crisis can sometimes become your biggest blessing. Isn't that, Madhvi?
Yes.
What hurts you blesses you, says Rumi. So, if it had not been for that quote-unquote death sentence, as you said, you wouldn't have become a swimming champion.
No.
She not only became a swimming champion, ladies and gentlemen, she did that at the age of 40. Incredible, incredible, incredible. I don't have words. She did that at the age of 40. Now, the interesting learning for us here is that the wiring for people who have a never say die attitude, in Madhvi's case, literally, because she was given a death sentence with only 1 year to live, and she has come this far to 2020, is that people with a never say die attitude always look at ways in which they can function despite the limitations. Many people ask me and Vani, how do you cope? 13 years, is there light at the end of the tunnel? And I always say in reply that like in cricket, so in life, until the last ball is bowled, anything is possible. I can see that spirit in Madhvi. And two other things that I want to pick up and highlight here. When she spoke about driving, she said she enjoyed it. She found that sense of freedom. And she said the same thing about entering water and discovering that sense of freedom. What does that tell you about life, ladies and gentlemen? It tells us that no matter how bad, quote unquote, bad things get, life will always give you what you need to move forward. Thank you, Madhvi, for sharing that. But let me move on and ask you my next question. You could have stayed with swimming. You could have been in the comfort zone of being a national level and international level champion in para swimming. But why did you embrace basketball, wheelchair basketball? What's the story there? How did that transition happen? I feel again from one comfort zone, you decided to move into a new area.
Yeah, one UK-based not-for-profit organization, Chais International, they approached me in 2013. So they told that they wanted to promote this sport in India. They were looking for partners in India. So when they told about this sport, I was very much impressed because till that time I was into swimming only. So swimming is an independent game. But here it is a team game, and where I could see an avenue for inculcating leadership skills and team spirit among the disabled. And another thing, like any youngster, they will have a lot of dynamism, activeness in them. They have so many non-disabled people are having so many avenues to showcase it. But for the disabled, they don't know. Disabled youngsters also will have all those things. But I saw that a very, very dynamic sport, this wheelchair basketball. I saw that it's another avenue for these disabled people to showcase their dynamism, their activeness, everything. So I liked that concept. Then I told that I have SV2 Ken One Trust. So then I told them I will support. So they brought the coach. It's a new sport for India. They brought the coach. I made local arrangements inviting persons with disabilities and arranging court like that. That went very well. That was only one day camp, but it went very well. So later we arranged with a 5 days camp, bringing one Australian coach. It was an amazing experience to watch those 15-20 kids from different parts of Tamil Nadu, from particularly rural areas. Through government department support, we brought them. For them, seeing such type of, we arranged a camp bringing that coach. So seeing such type of international standard, stadium and foreign coach, it was first time in their life. First day, even when they were telling their name also, we could not hear. But final day, they were shouting with a lot of confidence. Their faces were blooming with their happiness, everything. More confident. I arranged translators. But without taking their help, these people don't know other than Tamil anything. That coach know only their English like that. But they managed with the body language. It went wonderful. Then we thought that we should take it up to the entire country, not only to Chennai. With the like-minded people, Kalyani with the last experience in this social sector, and Aranjyoti, physiotherapist, you know, he's into sports medicine specialist also. And Raj Sekaran, you told earlier about Raja. He is having great knowledge about the disability sector. And Preeta initially, later Vishal, he joined us as a treasurer, chartered accountant. And Santi, another para swimmer and wheelchair basketball player, and Jagan, some other players. All of us together, we started this federation. And we started, now we are able to reach out to 23 states also. It was a great experience for all of us. And we are seeing the results.
So beautiful that this happened in this manner. You know, when you're narrating it, what I'm picking up is that how your life's purpose kind of found you. You know, all our life experiences always take us in the direction of where we must arrive. We don't know this when we're going through it. We don't know we are going to arrive there. But life is actually telling us, come here, I'm waiting for you. And so it is drawing us to where we must arrive. And that's what I'm thinking of. If you had not done, got that death sentence, if you had not got hydrotherapy orientation, and then if you had not enjoyed and become a para swimming champion, you would not have entered into wheelchair basketball space at all. And now that you are in wheelchair basketball space, you're touching and changing the lives of so many people. This is amazing. And I can only say that when you don't bring your fears, your insecurities, your opinions, your concerns, your inhibitions, when you don't bring any of these into play and you just follow life, your life's purpose will find you. And that life will become very beautiful. Madhvi, I would have ideally liked to ask you a question to share some stories of people of how their lives have been transformed. But I'm going to keep that for later because I'm just managing time on the side. And I'm going to ask you a question on how do you actually manage the Wheelchair Basketball Federation sitting on your wheelchair? Because, you know, one of the things that we saw firsthand, ladies and gentlemen, is that Vani and I were invited by Madhvi November last year to address the national women's team of wheelchair basketball. And she drove us herself to the stadium in Ayanavaram where we went and addressed that team. And we just saw what all goes on into creating a team. So Madhvi, my question is coming from that first-hand experience. You need venues, you need volunteers, you need coaches, you need mentors, you need players, you need government on your side, you need to take them for international camps and tournaments. How do you manage all this? How do you lead the foundation?
Yeah, managing is not only me. Again, our executive committee is there. All of us together we'll do. The challenges part, as you rightly told, the biggest challenge first I give top priority to lack of awareness. Even today, many persons with disabilities, their parents, they themselves don't know these type of sports are there and they can also play. So first they need to know and society also need to know this is possible. Then only stadia will become accessible. We will have accessible transport. So initially, we saw all these challenges. But what we are trying to do, lack of awareness for that, we are trying to arrange camps in various parts of the country. We didn't stick to a few places. We arranged in Meghalaya, we arranged in Kerala, we arranged like that. So many places we arranged the camps. So by doing that, we are able to create awareness. When we arrange camp, anyway, media will come, some local NGOs will come, people will come to know this type of sport exists, this type of sport exists. So another thing, when we go there, we are trying to create awareness about the accessibility requirements. So in that stadium, we are telling that these are the changes we need. We need an accessible toilet, steps needs to be arranged here, one ramp needs to be arranged. Like that, we are trying to create awareness. And even national championships also, whenever we are arranging, we are trying to go to different places. One time in Chennai, one time in Hyderabad, one time in Mohali, like that, Delhi, various places we arranged. So that national championship is a very big event. Then government, everybody will come and they will come to know the requirements. And with the support of our well-wishers, our partners are there like Cognizant, International Committee of Red Cross. And wherever we go, we work with the definitely government. Government is having all infrastructure facilities. Definitely we work with the government and local NGOs. Over a period of time, slowly people are able to realize the benefits. They are seeing the amazing benefits. What are all the benefits it's bringing? How the confidence levels of players are improving, their recognition, and they are becoming like the heroes and heroines in their areas. So after seeing that, slowly things are changing, but still equipment related challenge also is there. We don't have sports wheelchairs in India, any manufacturer, we have to import. For that also, we are trying with some other people, approaching government also. If we are able to get a manufacturer in India, it will be easy. And also major requirement for this court is indoor basketball wooden court. So very few courts are there, wooden courts in India. So that is also one challenge. But right now, at least we are able to convince the place that the facility owners that they can give their court for wheelchair basketball also. Otherwise, many people will have fears that their court will get damaged. But this court is meant for wooden courts. Nothing will happen to wooden court. If it is not good, our chair tires will get damaged. Slowly, in this way, we are trying to create awareness. When awareness is there, definitely slowly support also will.
Which is more challenging for you, Madhavi, awareness or funds? What do you do for funds for running in a federation like this?
So we are how we work, no? We recently went for Paralympic qualifiers. Always we start with a zero balance. So, okay. People will get surprised at how we are taking up such big task without having funding. Some people think that we are mad also. You can understand, but around 12 players and coaches, we organize two camps. One is for 2 weeks, another one 10 days. For men, two camps, women, two camps, and paying their registration fee. Registration fee means, accommodation, food and local transport. For that, we need to pay for International Federation and flight tickets. So for doing all these things, you can see it's a more than 1 crore project. But how we did, we arranged camps in universities where they provided court at free of cost. Some places they gave accommodation or food. In one rehabilitation center, we arranged one camp. Like that, we split that requirements into different parts and approach different people. It need not be in cash. They can extend their infrastructure facilities or like that. So some corporate partners are there, like as I told, R.R. Donnelly, Cognizant, volunteering support. Actually, our organization is running with the support of volunteers. Majorly, they are doing so many things for us when we organize events or even while doing day-to-day activities also. Finally, we could make it, that Paralympic qualifiers.
What you're saying is very powerful. It's not to be taken lightly. It cannot be just taken as light humor. When you said, when we start with zero balance and then people think that we are mad, I want to tell you that every entrepreneurial journey, every journey of a new idea is seen by the outside world as a stupid idea, as a crazy idea. But unless you walk the line of lunacy, unless pagalpan ka wo bhoot aap pe sawar nahi hoga, if you don't walk on the pittalata illanaka, you cannot make things happen around you. That's what I'm picking up from you. But to kind of present it in a different light, in a different angle, I want to say that when you have integrity of purpose, this is the point that I used to introduce Uncommon Leader to everyone this evening. When you do things beyond you, when you look beyond what's in it for you and do it for a higher purpose, then life always opens doors. Life always brings the right people. And as Madhavi was speaking, there were chat messages coming in and that I was seeing where people talked about her energy on the basketball court, her ability to mobilize the right resources, her ability to connect with the right people. I think, Madhavi, you will agree that the reverse is also happening, that people are connecting people. One person is connecting you to another, and how the ecosystem is getting built, correct?
Yes, definitely.
Very true, very true. Madhavi, let me go on to ask you my next question. I think Group Captain also referred to it in his intro. I also referred to it in my intro, that you don't take no for an answer. Okay. Now, many people in your position would have been destroyed, defeated with the amount of challenges that you've been dealt with. But look at you. You are so full of energy, so full of life, so cheerful, so enthusiastic. What is the secret of your energy?
My energy comes from my challenges.
From your challenges? Wow. Okay.
Yes.
Tell us a little more.
You know that PPS, post polio syndrome, that gave me so many opportunities. It transformed my life to a sports person and also sports administrator. And next challenge I faced 1 or 2 years ago, doctors told that I have hiatus hernia. Hiatus hernia, first time I heard, I never heard that type of hernia. That is like a stomach entering into the diaphragm. So it's a very, it's a dangerous situation. If stomach goes more into diaphragm, then it stops the lungs functioning. Then when I came to know that doctor suggested me, okay, you need to eat some sattvic food. Anyway, I eat like that only, so no issues for me. And then they told that you try yoga, particularly pranayama. So after that, I started learning yoga more and pranayama. And I, because I'm a swimmer, I experimented in water. And now I can do aqua yoga also. So I learned that. So this hiatus hernia gave me the opportunity to learn more about the greatness of yoga. Now I want to tell everyone, you start yoga from your childhood. That is very good. Like that, I want to tell everyone. So, and then the aqua yoga, I could do experiments in that. And later, recently, I got some 3-4 months back, this elbow pain, severe pain. I came to a stage where I felt like I could not use my hands at all. That much pain. We thought initially golfer's elbow. Later, my physiotherapist found it is because of excessive usage, this structure became weak. Then I realized how much important for me were elbows, because I can't use legs. My every movement is putting pressure on my elbow. All the doctors unanimously suggested you take rest for some time, except going to office, don't do anything. Then that also gave me one nice feeling, taking rest also good. We should listen to our body. Most of us, we don't listen to the warnings, whatever our body is giving. I also didn't listen. So it brought me to a stage where I can't move. Then after some time, again, slowly I'm feeling better. But all these issues, whatever I told, it will be there till my last breath. Now I realized how to live with all of them. And now this lockdown period also is giving me a great opportunity to know that what are all the things we can do sitting at home. I'm working from home. And as I told earlier, I love to acquire qualifications. I love to learn new things. Now I'm doing a course on mentoring and coaching. And also I'm wheelchair basketball. We have taken up a project. We are trying to support our players during this COVID time. We are trying to do a need assessment with the support of one organization. Once we do that, we are trying to support them. So many things I am doing now, this talk also, so busy. So I realized that how many things we can do during this lockdown. So my every challenge is giving me more and more energy and making me more strong, making me stronger and more confident.
You know, when you were talking, somebody sent a message saying you are unstoppable. You're truly unstoppable. Someone else, I think it was Varadarajan, who said that boost is the secret of energy. I will change that and use your line, Madhavi, that your energy is coming from your challenges. Now, I want everyone to just pause and reflect. She has a polio condition. 80% of her body is paralyzed. She has a lung which has been shrunk.
Partially working. One lung partially working.
She has one lung and that is partially working. And then she has a hiatus hernia, which is pushing her diaphragm into the intestine, right?
No. Stomach into diaphragm.
Stomach into the diaphragm. And then she has, she has this attitude to tell us that she loves her challenges and the energy comes from challenges. You know, some people are born to thrive in challenges. Madhavi is one of them. The former CEO of Intel, once said that give me a quiet world and give me a turbulent world and I will pick up the turbulent world, he said. And he also said in the same breath, he said, adapt or die. So I think life will be full of challenges. And your ability to adapt, your ability to work around the challenges is what will shape you. I think Madhvi summed it up all very beautifully, how she has used the lockdown period and how she's even using this conversation to try something totally new, which she hasn't done before. We love and salute your spirit of adventure, Madhvi. I'm going to ask you one last question. And at this point, I want to invite all those of you who want to ask questions, to ask us questions here or on any of the platforms that you're on. And we'll take a few questions. The best of them will be taken, but all questions will get virtual happiness hugs. Okay. Meanwhile, I will ask my last question to Madhvi for the evening. Madhvi, what is your idea of happiness? Since we are the happiness walas, I always like to conclude my conversations with this question. So what is your idea of happiness?
Yeah, being a person with a disability and being a person working for a social cause, I got wonderful opportunity to experience the warmth and affection of so many people. Maybe some small boys or girls or very elderly people or people working in some like in parks like that, those who are working there or company CEOs. Like that, many people after seeing me, they will come forward and trying to ask whether I need any help like that. Whenever such type of things happens, you know, I feel so happy. People are thinking about others. So that is a great thing. And when I'm working for the social cause, recently, yesterday, one thing happened. A group of youngsters, Juhi and her friends, they told me that we are ready to support our players during this COVID situation. They told that we are all youngsters, we can't give big amount, but any small requirements are there, you please tell madam. So then four of our players' requirements are also small now. They need only vegetables, groceries, medicines like that. Four players' requirements came to around 7,500. Within half an hour, all those youngsters, they made arrangements and they transferred the amount to the players also directly. So I felt so happy. I'm very, very hopeful of very positive and bright future for the world. If youngsters are like this, if they are thinking for others, how the world is going to be in future. I'm very, very happy for that. And whenever I put so many efforts for doing one good thing, and if it brings any small positive change in the lives of others also, it gives me amazing happiness. I'm very, very happy to see all these things.
Madhvi, I don't know how to thank you for that perspective. You've shared a point of view which is so evolved, and yet you shared it so simply. You know that when we start our journey, our adult lives, we always start with the question, how can we be successful? How can we do something for ourselves? How can we achieve name? How can we achieve fame? At least that's the way majority of the society is conditioned. How can I make more money? So what's in it for me is the first question. That is the definition of success. But as you grow in life, as you evolve in life, you reach a point where you revisit the definition of success. And you say, how can I make other people happy? How can I touch other people's lives? How can I make other people understand the value of this gift of this lifetime? And that is true success. And I think in answering my question on happiness, you have actually defined what true success is also, which is making other people happy, making it a better world. Thank you so much. A beautiful answer there. I'm going for the first question for the evening, which has come from Varadarajan, which says, what are your three or four powerful tips that you would like to give women across various strata of society, especially because you have gone through so many challenges? What are your three or four tips that you would like to give women across various strata of society?
Yeah. It's like I never, being a woman with a disability coming from village, people used to tell me so many times, you are a woman, how can you do this? You are a woman with a disability, how can you do this? Better don't try that one. But what I strongly suggest, if you believe in that one, whatever you want to do, you want to become a teacher, doctor, or whatever, pilot, whatever it is, if you strongly believe in that, you please move forward. when you start doing that one, the family members or friends, whoever didn't support once upon a time, they will come forward and slowly support and encourage you. That will come. So definitely it will come. So be confident, and whatever passion you are having, you please try to take it up. And another thing, please give importance for fitness. Many women we know very well, they always think about their family members, their job, all these things, but fitness part they may not think that much. Please listen to your body. Your body gives signals that I can't do this further, you have to take care of me like that. Please listen to your body and improve your fitness. If you are healthy, your family will be healthy, and your organization also, you can extend more support to that organization. And another thing, that whatever you want to achieve, you need not get scared. You don't think that if I take it up senior positions in our organization, I may have more work, and then I may not be able to contribute to the house, household related work like that. I strongly believe that if you start educating your children and your family members about sharing the responsibilities, so definitely you can take it up your senior positions in the office, and also you can manage your house successfully. So please aspire for higher positions wherever you are.
Beautiful. Very well said, Madhavi. Here's a question coming for you from Ravi. Madam, do you plan to write your autobiography someday, because it can motivate many youngsters?
My uncle has been telling me you should write. Definitely, I'll try to find time to start writing it. I love to do that.
Here's a question from Mohan. Did you at any time feel dejected in life? If so, how did you overcome that negative feeling?
I told so many experiences. I don't know, it's a manufacturing defect. Always I'll be positive only. Whatever problem comes, I will try to find a way to overcome that one. So, okay, I am a human being. Immediately when something happens, I may feel sad, bad for some time. But I can't be in negative feeling for a long time. I will come out from that very fast. I can't be in a negative feeling for a long time.
So there is a related question from Raj Munje here. Raj is saying, asking, so is this secret, the secret of bouncing back from a negative position, obviously, is this secret inborn to you, or is this something that you have cultivated?
I think just now I told you, no, it's I think inborn only. So from the beginning, I'm seeing I'm a very cheerful person. I will try to do things. I will understand the others also. I step into the shoes of others. If anybody criticizes me or anything, I will try to understand, because most of the people try to disappoint me in so many times. Don't go to cities, don't take up promotions, don't go to another MNC bank like that. But I know very well, they are my well-wishers. They have their own fears. That is why they try to stop me. When we understand others, I don't think we'll have more negative feelings.
So beautiful. When you understand people around you, you are not likely to have negative feelings. Wonderfully said. Paul Bhaskaran, an MMA member, asks you, Madam, what is your long-term goal?
Till now, if I see my life, yeah, it's like I love detective novels, suspense thrillers. But my life became like, hey, it's more thrilling, because 15 years back, somebody told me that you are going to become a sports person, sports administrator like that. I would have thought that person is mad, but you can see the changes. I don't know what are the changes are going to happen in the future, but definitely whatever I do, I will think about my fellow beings. I will try to do my best. That's my lifetime goal, two goals. One, I should be financially independent. Second one, try to do something for others. So there won't be any change in those aims from my childhood, same aims. The works what I am doing may change.
That's a very important point. Be independent, both financially and personally, be independent and do good for others. this, if you connect it back to who makes an uncommon leader, somebody who goes beyond asking the question, what's in it for me? That answer is what you get. We have an offer from Vidya Shankar, who says if you're looking for a co-writer for your autobiography, she's raising her hand. So you have,
thank you, you so
have,
much.
You have a co-writer. Vidya Shankar is a poet and an author. And, you know, so she will perhaps make a good collaborator, Madhvi. Meanwhile,
please,
I have
please share her contact with me.
Yes, I will surely. I will surely see how the universe connects people.
Yes.
We're going for the absolutely last question of the evening, which is a question to Madhvi from Raja of Vishesh, the gentleman who connected us. He says, you juggle many balls, work, home, WBFI, swimming association. What is the secret of managing to stay on top of it all? And what are the challenges that you're currently dealing with? Are you dealing with any current challenges? Keep it
current
a very sharp, tight answer, Madhvi, because I have to do a wrap and hand it over to Vijay.
Okay. So right now, the challenge what we are facing is like capacity building of Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India and the state association. We want to strengthen both the things, state associations and the federation. That's the immediate challenge for us. We are together with the support of coaches, all our technical people, classmates, everybody together, we want to achieve this one.
Thank you. Again, look at her, very modest. Again, turn the attention from herself to what she's dealing with and what she wants to do for the Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India. So Madhvi, that's truly a manufacturing blessing. I won't call it a manufacturing defect. It's a manufacturing blessing that you always look at the world from where you are seeing it from the outside and never at yourself. Here is an uncommon leader, which in all the...
Before you conclude, I just want to ask a question. Final question.
Please go ahead.
The question is, madam, this is so passionate. And everybody's got a passion in them to do something. I know people like A.R. Rahman, he had a music passion. I know Muhammad Ali for boxing, F.M. Hussain for painting, and similarly Sunil Bharti Mittal for business success. Now, how do you bring out the passion? Everybody has got in it. Then how do you bring out the passion in them? Maybe a few tips from you will really enlighten the people who have in it in them, but they don't know how to bring it out, actually.
Yeah. Many, even when I attended some colleges like that for talks, they're also questioned, madam, how can we manage our passion? And parents are scolding us, don't go with your passion. You do get a good job like that. So I know practically we know very well that we can't leave our jobs and jump into our passion. So definitely what I feel like with our free time, we should, whatever, everybody will have some interest. Somebody may like singing, somebody may have some painting or something. But they may keep it aside. But I always strongly suggest every one of you, however busy you are, please spend some time in your passionate work. That will, it's like a meditation. It will give you a lot of mental satisfaction and calmness. Whatever you like, please spare. It may be a gardening, it may be a reading or whatever it is. Please spare a few minutes. Then you will realize the importance of having that passion and encouraging to continue that one.
Lovely answer.
Thank you. No, pick boy. Thank you.
Lovely answer there. You know, we curate the Bliss Catcher series, so I can completely relate to following your bliss immersion. Good point there, Madhvi. Madhvi, to me, is an uncommon leader who's still uncommon among uncommon leaders. I'll tell you why. Because if you look at the journey, 80% of your body is paralyzed. You are not admitted into high school. You start teaching people at home to stay connected with the world around you. You learn typing, hoping that you can convince LIC. You go and fight a challenge, which is a pediatrician's opinion at the government bank, and convince them to employ you. You learn how to ride a scooter. You learn how to drive a car. Which is with 80% of your body being paralyzed. Then when, quote unquote, her own words, when a death sentence is served, she goes and learns swimming and becomes a champion. And then she goes on to lead the world, the Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India across 23 states. 650 people have been touched and their lives have been transformed through this. This is a beautiful story of, to me, reflection, resilience, and resourcefulness. Reflection, which is how can I make things better for the world around me? Resilience, how can I be independent despite the given challenges? And resourcefulness, how can I work around my challenges? The way she leads the World Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India is a case in point. So Madhvi, to us, you are resilience personified. To us, you are an uncommon leader. So thank you so much for sharing your thoughts.
Many
comments coming here saying they are, saluting you for your spirit. I'll share them with you later on. And before I hand it over to Group Captain Vijay Kumar, I want to thank everyone for joining us. Our next edition of Uncommon Leader is on the 1st of July, where we have a very interesting personality coming up. We are the Happiness Wallas. Google us, HappinessWallas. If you want to register for any of our free programs, please inbox me at the Happiness Walla, happiness with a Y, at the Happiness Walla on Instagram, and we'll be happy to add you. Thank you so much, Vijay. Handing it over back to you. It was wonderful doing this session on Zoom, and thanks, Team MMA.
Thank you, Avis. Thanks. I think we're all looking forward to the event on the 1st of July. Hope the 1st of July we'll have it in MMA with the social distancing norms, because we've got a 350 set of auditoriums, and where they can give one third to accommodate, we can accommodate 100, balance people can go, because always you do it on live, it makes all the difference. But notwithstanding, I didn't find much difference today in doing it in Zoom.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Up to the class, and we are able to really control the time and control the questions, especially when you hand over the mic, you know what happened, now it's much better. Madhuri Madam, you have been fascinating, because I am always get fascinated by looking at the sports person. If you are good at sport, you are good at everything. I'm a firm believer in that, because you bring in the sense of discipline in you, and it's really fascinating to hear your story. I'm quite sure large number of viewers who are watching this program live, the takeaway will be something good, what it will do good for them actually. And one thing I'm quite sure, we are doing free yoga every morning, and you said you must do yoga. I only wish all those people who are watching the program get up in the morning, join at 7 o'clock. You will learn something very good in life. And I can assure you, the yoga and pranayama does very good for you, because I do practice this, and it does quite a bit of flexibility in you. And whatever you want to do, it gives you a lot of balance, not only balance of body, balance of mind. It's good. I'm not promoting yoga, but I can tell you it does a lot of good, as Madhuri Madam said. Thank you, Avis. As usual, you've been wonderful. Great, fascinating. Shankar, can you please unmute everybody? May I request all of you to join? A round of applause to Madhuri Madam for the great.
Connect.
No, but because I was in Bengal for so many years, you know, I'm so used to the accent.
Thank you. I think a lot of comments are coming.
So I can easily pick up a Bengali accent.
Very good. And thank you so much. God bless you and God bless all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, always. Till we meet again. Bye-bye. And thank you, madam. Stay safe.
Thank you, sir.
For coronavirus and destiny in your hand.
I lived in Bengal. I lived in Orissa.
Safe distancing and take care.
English will be... no, my English will be English accented.